Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us today for our webinar, Email Delivery 101. My name is Jill, and with me today is Jennifer Noyes. She is our delivery manager. She makes sure your emails get where they're trying to get to. We have lots of great information for you today. As always, there will be time for Q&A at the end of the webinar, and I suspect that you will have a lot of questions because this is one of those things that people usually have a lot of questions about. Email delivery is pretty important for you. So if you think of questions along the way, go ahead and type those into the box that you see in your GoToWebinar window, and we will be happy to answer those questions at the end of the webinar. This webinar is about 35 minutes-ish. Depends how much time we spend on some of the slides. And as I said, at the end, there's plenty of time for Q&A. One of the questions that we get at pretty much every webinar is this being recorded? And the answer is yes, we are recording this webinar for you. This will be up on our help site, hopefully this afternoon. I have another webinar this afternoon, so it kind of depends on how busy I get today. But if not today, it'll be up there tomorrow. So if you want to go and refresh your memory on some of the stuff that we talked about, this will be available for you. So with that, let's go ahead and take a look at what we're going to talk about today. So these are the things that we're going to go over. We have a lovely picture of spam on there. We're actually going to be hopefully talking about something other than spam. So we're going to talk a little bit about email delivery. We're not going to go into deep details because this is a pretty technical tool or deal, but we are going to talk a little bit about email delivery, and then we're going to talk a little bit about anti-spam laws that will impact the information you can have in your email. And then we're going to jump into tips for your email. So we're going to basically go through your email from top to bottom and talk about the things that you need to think about to help get your email in the inbox when you're creating your email. As always, we have lots of resources, free resources for you guys. And then, as I said, there will be Q&A. So with that, we're going to jump into this, and Jen is going to take over.
Hello, good morning. We're going to start off with, do your emails get complaints? And I'm sure they do, even if they're opted in list. People can complain if you send them an email for the first time, you collected their email address 6 months ago and you just send them an email. People tend to forget and may hit the spam button, forget who you are. That'll generate a complaint. We like to see complaints stay below 0.3% average. If your complaints get higher than that, a vertical response delivery team will reach out to you and give you a little warning to see how you're collecting your list and see what we can do to work with you to lower the complaints. Complaints are usually associated with emails not being a permission-based, old list, improperly collecting your list, third-party lists that you purchased, that are not allowed with vertical response. we put an unsubscribe link in every email that gets sent out, but sometimes if your email background color could hide this, that could cause a problem. People don't see a way to unsubscribe, so they could possibly hit the spam button. And some people just hit the spam button by mistake. I'm sure everybody has seen that in Yahoo, Gmail. You just hit the spam button and we get what's called a feedback loop back to our abuse queue. And it lets us know that somebody has complained about your email. Sometimes these recipients will put in a message telling us they've never signed up for this or they just don't want to receive your email anymore. And again, if an email percentage of complaints that we get from your send, we'll reach out to you and let you know that, you know, we want to work with you and try to get your complaints lowered. High complaints affect everybody's email sends here at Vertical Response. It affects our IP reputation. Gmail specifically goes off what users are saying. So if a lot of Gmail complaints come in, they know that they're going to see a pattern with your emails and start filtering you into the spam box, regardless if you have a good opted-in list. If they see a lot of complaints, they go off engagement. So if your customers are hitting the spam button, Gmail will see this and just automatically filter your emails into the spam folder. So,
and this is a change that's happened over like the last like couple of years, that a lot of the mailbox providers like Yahoo or Gmail have started going more towards using engagement versus things like having the word free in the subject line, for example. Because it used to be a long time ago that there were certain triggers like free or something like that, make money from home, that would just put your email in the spam folder. And they've kind of moved away from basic things like that, and they've moved more towards people's engagement with the email itself.
Right. Yeah. For Gmail, Vertical Response was one of the first in their pilot program to be part of their feedback loop complaint. They don't tell us who's complaining. They give us a percentage and an identification, and that's how we can associate you. And then we'll work with you to try and get these complaints lowered. Gmail feels if there's a reason why your Gmail customers are complaining, it's because they're not opted in. So we will work with you and try to get your email in the inbox. The next bullet point is, does your email hit spam trap addresses? A spam trap is when somebody signs up for an email at Yahoo or Hotmail, and then they never use it. For 6-7 months, they've never logged in, they never use it. Those ESPs, internet service providers, will take that email address and turn it into a spam trap. So they know that that is not an actual live account. And what they do is they put that in. They don't really tell us how that works, otherwise it'll
we would mess work up around it.
We would be able to take that email out of your list so you wouldn't hit them again. But sending to old email addresses can definitely turn into spam traps, and then in turn that can get Vertical Response blacklisted if you get too many spam trap hits. So we will work with you on that. If we identify somebody in your account that is a spam trap address, we want to know how you collected your list. That's why we always ask, how old is your list? Nowadays, people change emails so frequently, and you know, people's email addresses get old. So we advise anything older than 6 months, if you have an email to them, you know, to break up your list. The next one is, how high are your invalid addresses or bounce rates? So there are two different kinds of bounces. There is the hard bounce and the soft bounce. Hard bounce to us indicates a permanent reason why that email was not delivered. It could be that the recipient's email address doesn't exist, the domain doesn't exist, or even if it's misspelled, the recipient could have permanently blocked that email from going through, and those will come back as a hard bounce. Soft bounces, we try to deliver up to 3 days. After 3 days, it'll well turn into a hard bounce and it won't be mailable. So soft bounces typically indicate a temporary delivery issue to that address. So depending on what the issue is how we'll get it delivered. Again, there are many reasons why an email may soft bounce, but the common ones could be that the recipient's email mailbox is full, their server is offline or it's down, or the email message is just too big and it can't be accepted. The next bullet point, mailbox providers have their own criteria for content as well as use spam filters. Spam filters change every day. I just recently was talking to an old customer who's been a client of Vertical Responses for 10 years, have been getting mail fine, and then all of a sudden they stopped getting their emails. So after troubleshooting with them, we figured out that their company changed their firewalls on their end. So I had to work with their IT department and make sure that they're familiar with Vertical Response, that their firewalls want to receive emails from us. And once I worked with them, we got that fixed. They were able to get mail from us. But if it's an unknown, if somebody receives an email and they don't recognize Vertical Response, the spam filter says, whoa, wait a minute, we don't want mail from these people. So there's certain things we can do. We have whitelisting information available in our articles. We give people tips on how to get the email past the spam filters. So the next bullet point is the email content that can cause delivery issues.
And there's a lot on this. We actually are going to go into more detail about this later in the presentation. But
the biggest thing is always test it yourself. Send an email, launch it to yourself, see where it ends up for you. Did it go in the inbox? Great. You know, is it one big image? It's always good to have an image and text. Don't use a lot of color or bullet points. You want it to look professional and like not too many highlighted blues and yellows. You want to keep your HTML code clean and formatted properly. The biggest no-no is pasting from Word. When you paste from Word, behind the scenes, a lot of MSO code comes in, and when you look at that code, it's ginormous. So when you go to send it, the email, the ESPs look at that and it looks like spam. So it'll either not get delivered or it'll go into your spam folder. So this is the Canadian anti-spam law I'm going to talk about quick.
That's Castle.
Basically, we had a lot of confusion around this. We are compliant with CASEL. We can't give any law information out to you. You could always go to their website to look at the correct terms. Basically, to be compliant, Vertical Response is you have to make sure that you have your name and address in the body of your email, which we make you do in the first step of creating an email. It's down in the footer. You have to have the physical mailing address, the contact information, the unsubscribe link, which Vertical Response puts in the bottom of the email, which cannot be removed. And you definitely have to send to an opted-in list.
And that's really the biggest difference between the U.S. CAN-SPAM law and the Canadian anti-spam law, CASEL, is the purchase list aspect. Most of the other stuff is pretty much the same. It's like your from label and subject line have to be accurate. You can't change the headers. You have to have unsubscribe. All of that stuff is the same. But the CAN-SPAM law actually allows you to mail to a purchase list as long as you have an unsubscribe link. And the Canadian and European laws, they have the same laws. You can't use a purchase list. It has to be opted in.
And there's a ginormous fine if you don't.
Yes.
If you don't comply with their laws. So if you have a list that, God forbid, you purchased, and you're mailing to Canadian customers, starting, they're going to lax I think it starts in 2017.
Yeah, so the Canadian law went into effect last July, but they have like a 2-year grace period for people to be able to get their lists in order.
Correct.
In order to be in compliance with the new law.
Yeah. I mean, it's never good to send to a purchase list.
No, that just and causes... again, as you said, vertical response doesn't allow you to mail to a purchase list, nor do any of the other email service providers that compete with us. We all have the same rules. You can't mail to a purchase list. It's just, there's just too many unknowns in terms of what kind of addresses are on there. Some of the things that Jen was just talking about with spam trap addresses or old addresses, those are sort of the things that can end up on a purchase list. And, you know, it's a terrible way to start a relationship with a potential new customer buying their address. People don't really like that. So, I mean, there's a number of reasons not to use a purchase list, but being in compliance with the law is certainly a good reason to not do that. and then this is some more of the things that are required by the different spam laws. Again, you have to have an opt-out mechanism. The link that we have in the footer is great. It has to, you have to get it removed within a specific amount of time, and it has to be active for a specific amount of time. So you can't just tell someone, here, click this link, and then at some point that link goes dead. So that's why using a service like Vertical Response can actually help you be in compliance with the laws regarding sending email. The rest of it is you have to have a postal address. Again, that's both laws. You have to have a valid postal address for the sender of the email. And again, that's in the footer, so you don't have to worry about that. As Jen said, there are large fines if somebody complains about your email being spam, and they can do that if you are not in compliance with the rules. Vertical Response tries to help you stay in compliance, but it ultimately is up to you to make sure everything is going the way it should be. And the last thing on the castle point there is they do say that you need to have proof of sign up to mail to somebody in Canada. And that's what this two-year grace period is about, is to make sure that everybody has given you permission to mail to them and you have some kind of record of it. So that's where a sign-up form comes in handy, because you'll have an electronic record of that. If you're using something that's more less technical, where people are like signing on a piece of paper, you're going to have to keep that stuff. But you have to have some kind of record if they ask for it, which could happen in the U.S. as well, if somebody complains about your email being spam.
So Vertical Response's anti-spam policy, we went over a little bit of this, but absolutely no purchased, rented, or harvested list, third-party list, are allowed through Vertical Response. Basically, this causes high complaints. High complaints can cause blacklisting. It's a trickle-down effect. So one person that purchased a list could mess it up for a lot of people using Vertical Response. Being blacklisted, there's thousands of blacklists out there. We send millions and millions of emails. It's bound to happen. We take care of it. We get delisted. The repercussions of our other senders are not that bad, because we do jump on it and take care of it right away. But using a purchase list does have bad effects, because when you get an email from somebody you don't know, you complain about it. All those complaints affect our IP reputation. Our IP reputation is what gets our email into the inbox for our good customers. So we want to maintain a high delivery rate, a great IP reputation, and we want to stay off blacklist. That's our big goal. So we don't allow any of that. You only want to mail to people who opted in to want to receive your email. That's how you get good open rates, low bounces, low unsubscribes. People recognize who you are and will open your email. There's good opt-in forms. You can create one through Vertical Response and put it on your website. We do have a lot of customers who sign up at a trade show, and that's okay. We do usually ask for proof of an opt-in form, but when it comes to trade shows, it's a little bit more different. people could either, you know, drop a business card off in a fishbowl and say, you know, I want to hear about more about your product. That's perfectly okay. It's not okay when you have, you know, 300,000 lists from your trade show. Generally, that's an indication that that 300,000 list is not opted in. So,
well, yeah, the thing with trade shows is you can often get the list if you're exhibiting of all the people who have signed up to attend. That's not opting in. All they've done is sign up to go to the show. And while a lot of people expect that somebody's going to send them an email, they haven't actually requested an email from you. And so that is a no-no from our perspective. That is not opted in. But it is opted in if they drop a card in your fishbowl or you scan their tag at the trade show because they said, yeah, send me more information. That is opted in. So there's trade shows are a good way to grow your list, but you have to do it in the right way.
I think that's it. That's it.
So now we're going to dig into the different aspects of your email that can help or hinder your email getting into the inbox. And we're, like I said, we're going to basically start at the top and work our way through. And so we're going to start with the from label.
So the from label is so important because you're being recognized. You're going to get more of an open if somebody recognizes your from label. So you don't want to be misleading in any way. You want to tell your customers who you are. That's the first indication. That's like super important. We ask recipients to add their from address to their address books. It's an easy way to help keep future emails out of the spam folder. It's really easy, but I don't think a lot of people do this.
No, some people do. I mean, you'll see it sometimes at like the top of the email, maybe where the click here to view in a browser link is, or sometimes at the bottom, people will say, add our address to your address book. I think people used to do it a lot more than they do now.
I think so too. So avoid changing your from label name every other email you send. people won't open it if they don't recognize it, or they'll mark it as spam. And then your next email may go into the spam folder because they hit the spam button the previous time. So, you know, you want to avoid 1973 at just weird from labels. You want to either make it from your company or your name, your first and last name, how the person is going to recognize you.
And that's really the important thing is what is going to make them want to open the email? Well, they need to know who's sending it. Mm-hmm. So you need to say who it is. And most of the time, people will recognize a company name before a person's name, unless you're like their dentist or something. But for the most part, a company name is what you would put in your from label and then stick with it because people start recognizing it. And then our next part is the subject line. So in terms of email marketing in general, the from label and subject line are super important just because that's what gets your readers to know who's sending it and make them want to open the email. So there are two things that you actually should spend some time on when you're creating your email. But there are rules around the subject line, just like there's rules around your from label. So all the spam laws in the world say that your subject line has to be related to the content in your email. You can't trick people into opening the email. And one of my favorite examples of this happened a number of years ago here, but somebody was trying to send an email through our system, and the from label said, free sushi. And I was like, free sushi? Who gives away sushi? So I was looking at the email, and we do approve emails as they go out through our system, so this is what I was doing at the time. And the content of the email was all about working out and like some like protein powder or something, but there was nothing in the email about sushi, free or otherwise. There was nothing free. There was no sushi. They were just trying to trick people into opening their email, which then made me think that they didn't have an opted-in list because they were trying to trick people. So I had to stop them from mailing through our system. But that's the sort of thing that the anti-spam laws frown on, is just tricking people into opening your email. So you should have fun with the subject line, but it should have something to do with what's going on in the email itself. And then there's some spam techniques. I have spam in quotes there. Again, you don't want to do something that makes your email look like a spammer is sending it, especially if it's a legitimate email. The word free is no longer a word that really puts your email in a spam folder. If you look at all the emails you got in December, probably at least half of them said free shipping in the subject line, and they didn't go to the spam folder. So the word free is not really one of those things that causes it to go to the spam folder. But if you do spammy techniques like breaking it up with asterisks because you think it's a bad word, then you're going to start running into some issues with your delivery. And don't go crazy with the punctuation or capitalization. Again, that's something that spammers do. It's annoying to the people reading your email, but it's also something, if you look at the emails that do go into your spam folder, the ones that are legitimately spam, they have a lot of misspellings. They have tons of exclamation points. They are definitely using techniques that you don't want to use. So try to avoid using those. And then also you can't use re or forward, the regarding or forwarding, in your subject line if the email wasn't actually being forwarded or resent back to the initial person. That's actually against the canned spam law. You can't do that in your email. Again, that goes back to the top part where you're tricking people into opening an email because they think they've already read something in this thread. So you can't use that in your subject line. If you try to do it here, we'll stop you. So your content also is really important. And Jen and I were talking yesterday, so she has a story to tell you on this. It's probably better than my free sushi one. But your content in your email will definitely impact what happens to where it's going to land. And as Jen was saying earlier, a lot of the email providers like Gmail are actually looking at how engaged your readers are, which means your content is really important. Tell your story about the links, because I thought this was a great story.
So I was working with a client who all of a sudden this email that they were testing was not being delivered to them at their work. And I opened the email and I go to work on it, and it's a beautifully designed email, looks fabulous. I do what I do, and I test it, and I run it through a service that we have, and it looks great, it's coming back great, and something that I do is I will dissect an email to test it to see if the first part gets delivered into the inbox. If it does, I know that's not the problem. Then I'll start with the second portion of the email, send it, see where it lands. It's just a lot of testing. So I come to find out that after testing it, I noticed that the gentleman's links in his email were going to a government secure site. And the government was like, no, no, we're not going to accept this. As soon as we removed the links and resent the email, everybody got the email. Having links, you couldn't see where they were going. He had, you know, named it something else. But behind the scenes, it was linked to a government site. So that was the one thing that was allowing his mail to not to be delivered. So, you know, there's a lot of things that go into an email to try and get it in the inbox. It could look like the best email ever, and it's going to spam or not being delivered. There could be so many variables as to why it's not being delivered.
Yeah. So I thought that was a really good thing to know. I mean, it's the top thing on the slide here to make sure that you link to reputable sites. If you're going to include a link in your email, you should know what the site is that you're linking to, because there's lots of bad sites out there. And you know what? The email providers and spam filters and all of those things out there know these bad sites. And if you have a link in your email that's going there, it can definitely impact your delivery.
Even if the link you're linking to is on a blacklist, that could also trigger. They keep track of all of that, and as they scan your email to be delivered, if it comes up on a blacklist, they won't deliver your mail. So it's something you always should check for.
Yeah. Yeah, links can really be one of those things that causes your good email to go bad.
Yes.
You want to keep your email with a balance of text and images. Jen mentioned this earlier. Having just a single image as your email can cause delivery issues. Again, it's one of those things that spammers have been known to do. So make sure you have a balance of text and images. And another reason to do this just is for the sake of your recipients. Not everyone has high-speed internet access even today. And if for whatever reason images aren't loading or they're being blocked by the email program, your readers can still see all of the important details in your email, keeping them engaged. if all the details of your email are just in an image and that image doesn't load, then you're going to lose your readers. And some people may not see it depending on the delivery. Just like having a good link, if you're hosting your images not through Vertical Response, make sure it's a good system because, again, it's going to be a link. So if it's being hosted, it's somewhere sketchy. That could cause an issue for you. The no dears thing is, it's kind of funny, but this is something that's come about because you should know who you're sending your email to. And one of the spam techniques that we've all seen are those Nigerian...
Prince.
Yes, the Nigerian prince emails that say, hello, dear. And it's not your name, it's just hello, dear. And those are one of the things that can cause an issue. So if you're sending an email, try not to say, dear Bob. You can say hi, or you don't even need to have a greeting in your email. You can just start your email with the information that your readers need. You should always send what your readers are expecting. Again, that engagement piece is super important. If your email is suddenly talking about something that has nothing to do with your business, that spam button is really close and they might hit it, and that's a bad thing. And the last bullet I have on here is review your reporting regularly, and I think this is something that's super important. I know a lot of our customers think they're done when they hit that send button, but really looking at your reporting gives you a lot of information. Mm-hmm. It shows what your readers are interested in, so you'll see the links they're clicking on, the articles they're reading, how far they get through your email. That type of information is good for what you're going to continue to put in your email. But also, you need to see, did you suddenly have a spike in unsubscribes? If you did, you should take a look at what you changed. Did you change the content? Did you change your mailing frequency? There's a lot of things that can cause that, but you want to keep an eye on these things before we reach out to you.
Right.
So if you're looking at your reporting and you see a large bounce on one of the emails you sent, you should take a look at your list. Do you have an old domain in there? Did you get a new list and it's maybe not as good as you thought it was? Those are the sort of things that your reporting will tell you, and then you can be proactive about fixing these things so that we don't come to you and say, okay, you can't mail through us anymore. So then the other thing to keep in mind is the design of your email. So as Jen said earlier, having a huge email can cause a lot of problems. So that MS code on the back end, and I've looked at the code that Word puts out, it is not HTML, and it is very huge. So try to keep your email within a good size. If you're doing HTML, usually like 40 to 45 KB is a good size. You don't want it to go really big. You want to have a balance of text and images. Use alt text for your images so that it makes sense to your readers if they're not seeing your images. Try not to have a lot of colors in your email. Again, changing the colors of your font or having background colors. There's a lot of stuff that can cause issues, not only for your readers and the ability to actually read the email, which again could impact the engagement, but also cause problems with hitting the spam button, because again, you don't want that to happen. And you want to test. So Jen said earlier to test your emails, and I'm going to say test as well. Make sure when you send out your email that your design not only works for a person reading the email, but also comes to your inbox. Make sure you haven't done anything crazy in your code or something like that. And speaking of code, I'm just going to touch on the HTML just a little bit. I know not everybody is a techie, but if you are creating your own HTML and you're not using one of our templates, there are some things you need to keep in mind, or if there's a person creating it for you. I think the most important thing about HTML is that it should be clean and that you're using your nested tags and everything is closed. So you should have HTML body tags and then close all of those tags at the end of your HTML and then nest your tags correctly, which makes your HTML clean. And there are ways to make sure that it's good HTML. Validator.w3.org is a good one to use. I like that one. I think w3.org in general is a good website for HTML help if you're looking for info on that. I myself use that quite a bit. But just if it's not you creating HTML and somebody else is, just let them know this kind of information. In our resources, I have a guide for HTML for your email. So if you do have someone creating it for you, then there are tips in there. But bad HTML can cause your email to go to a spam folder as well.
And list.
We have touched on this a little bit.
We have, but you would be surprised how many people I have reached out to that have high complaints, and I ask them how they obtain their list, and they tell me, honestly, I bought a purchased opted-in list.
I've heard that myself. I'm not on the delivery team, but I have heard people say, but it's an opted-in list.
Yes.
It's like, no.
No, it's still purchased.
They opted in to hear information about horses or from our partners. Sometimes that happens, but those people didn't opt in with your business.
Right. And I just want to reiterate that having a good opted-in list just makes me happy.
And when Jen's happy, your email goes to the inbox.
It just makes everything flow perfectly. When you buy a list and attempt to send it out a vertical response, I will catch you. So it's not good. So like we always try and work with people, but if you have a purchase list, it has to be removed. It's against our law, canned spam law. It's just not a good thing all around.
I think one of the things though that that your team really helps with a lot, the delivery team, is if you have a list that is genuinely opted in, but maybe it's one that you haven't been very good or diligent about mailing to, or you don't mail very often, her team can do a lot to help you get that your
Absolutely.
List split up and sent out through our system. Usually what we'll recommend is just to break your list up so we can monitor any complaints that come in. So we're not going to, I mean, you're not going to be allowed to use a purchase list, but we can help you work with the list that you have and help get it up to snuff, basically.
Right. I mean, even if you have a list that's older than 6 months, we will allow you to use it. It's just not a good tactic. You want to, you know, engage with people that you've been talking to within a certain amount of time. So, you know, we definitely do work with you. We're not going to tell you no, you know, you can't use it. We have a great segmentation tool for situations like this, and you can segment your list out, and that's usually what we recommend. Sometimes, you know, we'll say just mail to Hotmail for right now, or just mail to Yahoo, or, you know, just mail to 10,000 or however many you have in your account, and we'll work with you on that. And I'll just go over the highlighted things here really quick. No purchase list, as you know. Clear unsubscribe, which vertical response is responsible for putting in the footer of every email. We do not allow for you to put your own unsubscribe in your email. You will get declined from one of the checkers and they will tell you to remove it. And this is because vertical response wants to capture all the unsubscribes, so we can track them for you. So if you have your own unsubscribe in your email and Billy Joe unsubscribes with you in our system, if you don't remember to, she's still a mailable email address. So you go to send your email, she's like, wait, I unsubscribed from this last time. That'll generate a complaint because now she's annoyed that she hit the unsubscribe from your unsubscribe and your email, not vertical responses. So we only allow one unsubscribe that we want to track and make sure everybody that wants to be unsubscribed is unsubscribed. having your customers add the email to the address book is a good thing. And then the segmented list that I talked about. And test. That's always a good thing.
So another thing that can help with your delivery is the frequency that you're sending your email. And as you've heard us talk in this webinar today, you need to mail on a regular basis. If you mail every 6 months, people are going to forget. Or if people have signed up to get your email and you don't send them an email for 2 months, they're going to forget. So you want to make sure that you're mailing on a regular basis. But you also don't want to be mailing too much, because right. then they'll unsubscribe or consider your email spam and hit that spam button. So usually we say to mail at least once a month, which helps with people remembering that they signed up with you, but also remembering that they should be getting your email and they don't hit it as spam. Plus, it helps keep your business in their mind, so when they need what you have, then they come to you. A lot of times we would recommend that if you're using a sign-up form or you have a piece of paper at your POS, that you mention what they're going to get in the email that they're signing up for, so like the type of content that you're going to send and how often you're going to send it. And then you need to stick to both of those things. Using a welcome email is a really good way to remind people that they signed up to be on your list. And it also gives you the opportunity to make them feel like they're part of your business because you sent them an email right away. Plus, you can give them, again, a heads up on how often you're going to be mailing and the type of content. We do have an automated welcome email that you can set up in the account, which makes it easy for you. If somebody signs up on your list, then you can automatically send them out an email that welcomes them to the list. And then as you start sending out your emails on like your monthly newsletter or the sale email that you're going to send out, then they're already on your list and they've been welcomed. And we just got through the holidays, but the holiday mailing is a thing that causes issues every year. Because, you know, for a lot of people, especially if you're in retail, Q4 is always a busy season because you're trying to get people to shop with you. And almost everybody increases the amount of emails that they send out. I think a lot of people expect it, but they do get annoyed. And I think what's important is that you manage their expectations. So if you're planning to change your frequency in mailing, just let them know. Send an email at the beginning of December or the middle of November and say, hey, we're going to start our holiday emailing. For the next 6 weeks, we're going to send you an email once a week. After the holidays, we'll go back to our normal mailing frequency. Then they'll know that there is a start and an end to this amount of email that they're getting, and that everything is going to go back to normal. I know there are just a couple of emails that I get like every month or whatever, every week, that let me know during the holidays that they're going to change their frequency. And I appreciate it. Mm-hmm. You know, I Absolutely. Think it's a great way to help keep people from unsubscribing or marking your email as spam. Okay, so this is just kind of a reminder of some things that can cause issues that we talked about today. So keep these things in mind when you're creating your email, and you should be good. Again, sending to an old list is something that can cause a lot of problems. I think Jen mentioned that quite a bit today. Not asking for permission or assuming that permission is forever is also something that can cause issues.
I have a story about this. Okay. I won't name the store name.
Oops. Okay.
But I was shopping. And I made my purchase, and the woman says, would you like your email printed, or your receipt printed or emailed to you? Mm-hmm. And I said, oh, you can email it to me. Well, I thought this was just for a receipt. I started getting inundated with hundreds of emails from them.
Wow.
I contacted them. I said, this is not opted in. You asked if I wanted my receipt emailed to me, and I said yes, and now all of a sudden I'm getting like 4 emails a day from you.
Wow.
So that's not okay.
Yeah.
That's misleading.
That is misleading. and the assuming permission means forever is that thing about people signing up and then not sending an email to them for 6 months. That's a long time to go.
Right.
Again, a welcome message is super helpful for reminding people that they're on your list. You need to test review your reports, and the list hygiene is keeping track of unsubscribes and bounces, checking to see how often you're mailing, when the last time was you've mailed to somebody. It's important to know these things. When you look at your list, you can see this type of information, or you look at your reporting, you can get this kind of information. But especially if you have a database outside of Vertical Response, you need to make sure you keep that updated as well as anything in VR. So we're coming to the Q&A part here. I see lots of questions in there. We do have two more delivery webinars this quarter. Jen and I are going to be bringing you lots more stuff.
Yeah.
So there's one on February 25th, how your email is impacted by spam laws. And Jen will be coming back from a conference the week before, so she will have lots of fresh info for you guys. And March 25th, how do ISP changes impact your email? So both of these are basically like today. They're on a Wednesday at 10 a.m. Pacific time. Hopefully you guys can attend one of those as well. And then these are some of our free resources. And I'm going to leave this up while we do Q&A. Our How to Do Everything site has lots of tips. Oh, I should have put in our... We have two help sites. There's also helpcenter.verticalresponse.com. with information on how to do your from label and your subject line and your content and your links in your email. Our blog also has some great information. We publish 5 days a week, which is a lot if you're writing for the blog, as I do.
All great information.
It is, and it's not about using Vertical Response. It is about marketing for your business, and we do have lots of list building info. We have information on Castle on there when that came through. We have information. Yahoo and AOL changed some things last year. We have a blog about that. So there's lots of great info on email delivery on our blog as well. And then we have some guides, which these are all ones that should help you with some of the stuff we talked about today. So HTML tips for designing your email. Design your email for delivery and response. 50 ways to grow your list. It's 50 ideas on how you can grow your list the right way. The ultimate guide to email delivery goes into some more details of what we talked about today, but a lot of what we talked about today is in that guide. Email delivery, vertical response, and you, and that's really about what vertical response is doing to get your emails to the inbox. So if you have a fascination with email delivery, we have a lot of help for you.